Everybody, this is, this is the Open Space and Trails meeting and coinciding with the Board of County Commissioners work session. We just went through some executive session stuff, and now we're in our public meetings. So this is our joint meeting with Open Space and Trails and the BOCC. Gary, you want to lead us through?
Sure, thanks. So, in your package, you have a memo about bike friendly. The Open Space and Trails Board has been working through this with staff for a couple months now on how they, the request has been to potentially look at bike friendly designation for Pickens County. Staff has worked on with Public Works on, what does bike friendly truly mean? How is the Public Works Department addressing bike friendly on roads? And, obviously our board knows how we do bike friendly in the open space program, but how do we meld it all together and come up with a countywide policy of being bike friendly? And then do we go for a bike friendly designation through this League of American Bicyclists? There's a couple communities in the valley that have bike friendly designation, Carbondale and the city of Aspen. It's a little more difficult in the county. It's not as easy to just stripe lines on sides of roads. You have to make sure they're wide enough to be able to handle that. There's a lot of other pieces to be involved. So basically, the memo in your packet is basically what we have come up with to this point. And it's kind of a combination of both departments on where we're going to go in the future. And so there's some staff comments and recommendations in there, but we wanted to just check in with both boards on what it really means to be bike friendly. And we have GR Fielding and Brian Pett here from Public Works, and Lindsay has been the open space staff responsible for it. But we wanted to have a discussion with both boards on being bike friendly, and have staff here to help answer any questions or provide any other direction. And basically our recommendation is to work to be a bike friendly community, but through policy and through improvements as we move forward. And then in the future, as we get further along with this, then potentially seek a bike friendly if we get to that point. But we also wanted to, that's why we have Brian and GR here in the BOCC, because we're dealing with pretty big budget issues when it comes to the road piece of this. So, guys, have any other further comments or questions?
I think the recommendation for me outlined it pretty well, that we're a bike-friendly community, but this is not necessarily the pursuit of this designation. Is it worth the time and energy to do all the things and make all the changes?
I think that as we went through our budget process, when we talked to discuss Road and Bridge Public Works budget, I think the BLCC agreed that we should be budgeting any future resurfacing, chip and seals on any of our roads to be quality for bicyclists. And along with that, to as you have in your memo, to install share the road signs as well. So I think that's a good start. I think that's it's an awareness by us that we want to provide quality and as safe as we can transportation for bicyclists on our roads as well as on our trails.
Michael?
One thing I think the Open Space and Trails can offer in their reauthorization is to put in some language that says we can participate in improvement to bike trails along roadways, and those constitute a legitimate Open Space and Trails project. And so that means widening the roads, improving the roads for bicyclists, and that can be a joint project between our road and bridge and open space and trails. And I think that will go a long way to making safe trails if we have wider roads with designated shoulders for bicyclists, a long way to making this a bicycle-friendly community. So I think that's something Open Space and Trails should consider.
I think that's a great suggestion. I know we are constantly bumping into things that we need to add to our reauthorization program, process, tweaks to the program. I sort of came at this from the other side of the coin and looking at the funds that are currently being spent on this. It seems like we've got, my note to myself is, who pays for this and why? And if we're, I guess I want to be assured that we're not spending Open Space and Trails funds on things that are not in allowed by the charter in terms of our staff time spent on working on the pickinoutside.com website, where we're analyzing the roads and seeing which ones are currently bike, you know, are bike friendly or popular bike routes.
You know, basically right now, no. I mean, I don't believe we're spending staff time doing that. I mean, we work with the Road and Bridge Department. They give us their list of roads that they feel that are bike friendly, and you know, most of the picking outside that we pay for by private funds. And so, but staff time is not really being spent on analyzing roads. We're not the ones analyzing the roads. We're taking that information from GRMR.
Great. And then the signage. The part of the signage, is that a part of Open Space and Trails budget? And we've got a whole sign program and sign designs.
Well, actually, if Brian or Jared doesn't mind, just to give an update on how they're going to do the signage is not coming from us, but I'd love them to give an update on how they're going to roll out that signage.
It's tied up right now with our road maintenance and management plan, which was formerly known as the asset management plan. We hope to bring that to the Board of County Commissioners in the month of January for the 2015 update. And in there will be a section that talks about bike-friendly roads and how we'll sign them and what roads are designated as such. So once that's done, then we can install the signs. That would be a public works effort. We already have some share the road signs that are out there, but this would be a more extensive signage effort.
Do we need to work on dovetailing Open Space and Trail signage with road and bridge signage on?
Well, the thing is, along roads, they have to be specifically, you know, a specific type of sign, MUTCD signage. So, you know, we include a lot of that in our signage program, but, you know, overall, it's, you know, the Public Works is going to work on their signage and, you know, on our trail system. It's a what we have in our trail system signage. So, you know, we try to work together to make sure that, you know, when a trail crosses a road, you have trail crossing signage, but that is usually always done by Public Works.
I think so. Collaboration and education is a big part of this. I imagine, I guess, a tourist riding on a road bike from in town up to Maroon Lake, one of the most popular rides we have. You know, if they just look at a map, then that sends them up 82 through the roundabout, you know, and up. Or if they have a little inside info, they can get on the bike trail, go over the Merle footbridge, and then they get to a point, they have to kind of figure out how to get up to the school, and then there's no sign, do you get on a Maroon Creek Road, right where all the students are getting dropped off and everything, or do you find your way through the school, and then you get, you know, and it's very complicated, and somehow I think we've got to figure out the route, and maybe it's putting a bike, widening Maroon Creek Road, putting a bike trail along Maroon Creek Road, but do you have the right of way, who knows, or how do you get through the school, and you know, that multi-jurisdictional stuff is really difficult. And then I think the other thing we got to think about is who sort of takes the lead on doing all of this. Is it Open Space and Trails that should be doing this? And maybe, I'm not saying they shouldn't, but, or is there another group that is maybe best at doing all that? So I've got a couple of concerns there.
I mean, those are, it's a good question on who takes the lead, because, you know, that example you gave was three different jurisdictions going up to the belt. So, you know, I think the reality is we got to start identifying some of this stuff, and that's what we're proposing to do over time, is to collaborate better so we can work with the city and work with Public Works and also work with Open Space to make sure that all the pieces are there. Plus, you know, with Picking Outside, we're starting to do a job with trying to put the road bike routes on there and stuff like that. So, you know, I think it's going to be an evolving process, but one of the big pieces that's really stemming from this is to really collaborate better between the organizations so we can do better signage and everything else. We're rolling out a new sign plan next year, and so our signage is going to change. You know, our collaboration with the city is always to look at better ways to sign things, and the Public Works people are going to be signing Share the Road and everything else. So I think that's something that we're going to continue on and see, and we'll give you progress updates on how we do it. But who takes the actual lead is something that we'll work on with the city to see how we go about doing that, because there's two big rides from the city that originate in the city is, you know, Castle Creek and Maroon Creek. And so maybe, like, it's to talk to Matt and Austin at the city and kind of see where we can go and stuff like that. And we'll come back with an update. Because the city, on their own thing, they're trying to do better bike routes and everything else. And so, you know, we'll see. Maybe they will take the lead on something like that.
And then are there any cycling clubs, like, I guess, Rafumbo led the charge on the city program, is that correct?
RFMBA?
Yeah.
RFMBA led the charge on getting the bronze level status for a ride center in the entire upper Roaring Fork Valley, Aspen, and Snowmass. So they led that effort. The city itself led the effort on the bike-friendly designation.
So maybe they should be involved.
The city?
No.
RFMBA?
Yeah.
Well, RFMBA might be interested in it, and, you know, they're more interested in the International Mountain Bike Association accreditation and not necessarily the League of American Bicyclists. But we've also talked with, you know, the Aspen Cycling Club, you know, is one of those pieces that could be potentially a group that goes for it. But I think we need to get some more of this stuff done before we're at that level. But I think we can do, you know, within the next year and a half, we can do a significant amount of improvement and then discuss the things like Michael brought up. Is, do we want to change our scope to potentially include road biking and road widening and road projects and stuff like that? And that's a discussion we'll have over the next year or two.
I had thought that we had come up with some roadblocks of spending Open Space and Trails money towards road construction and stuff. So this is county stuff or Open Space and Trails stuff. Obviously, we work side by side in these things, but these would be county road decisions, not Open Space and Trail road decisions.
Correct. Right now, that's the way our charter is.
Yeah. Okay.
It seems like where we could utilize Open Space and Trail staff resources is to, as Gary says, to work with Public Works, but to help identify possible routes and educate the public and guess how to get from point A to point B. I mean, that's a critical part of this.
And our website is the Picking Outside is maybe a key to that.
The Picking Outside was a huge step for us to really get our system, you know, somewhere where the public can start really planning their own rides, and they go on there and you know, they look at the road bike route, and maybe we work with the city and everything else to try to help direct that. But, you know, I think over time, when you look and you see a road bike route of Maroon Creek, you know, then all of a sudden you see the trails that lead to Maroon Creek. And so you can then connect the dots to make that connection to Maroon Creek Road. And then the second piece would be signage to make sure that, you know, the signage is also there to help people understand where they're going and stuff like that.
Are you looking for action?
No, we gave the staff recommendation, and you know, if you guys are comfortable with that, we're going to move forward and continue working on that. And this just gave us kind of more impetus to work together. And, you know, Michael's point was definitely something we'll discuss as we discuss through budgets and, you know, reauthorizations and everything else. We'll have to bring up that piece.
Graham, just one comment. I was delighted to see the staff recommendation and the reason for it. We've talked about this for the last couple of meetings. Howie, being on both boards, really got it on our agenda, and beginning maybe 3 months ago. And I think this is exactly the right course to take, not to go too fast. Really learn from Summit County, learn from Carbondale and Aspen, involve the users, and not take on too much on the staff, given all the other things that are already prioritized. I think it's totally supported.
Cool. On the moving on from bike friendly, you know, one of the big things, you know, we haven't really worked together as both boards at a joint meeting is, you know, what we have seen over the past 2 or 3 years is this resurgence of the agricultural piece to our mission. And so we just wanted to make sure the BOCC is truly aware of, you know, the direction the open space program is going with agriculture. We put in the packet the agricultural lease bid process, and with the adoption of the glacier management plan, which is upcoming, you know, we're going to start putting this lease bid process into practice. And it's really directing a different way of managing our properties, our leased properties for agriculture. In the past, we have been, you know, pretty much, we buy an agricultural piece of property, we look to a neighboring ranch to help us manage that piece of property. We create a lease with them, but it's really just about keeping the water rights going, keeping the property weed-free, maintained for us. But what this process does and our focus in the future is really to try to create different types of agriculture on our properties, to foster an agricultural community that's really been developing in this area, and to allow different types of agricultural uses on our properties while still maintaining significant, you know, sustainability, looking at ways to go to more organic and natural production, protecting our water rights, but also looking for efficiencies in water rights. And so, you know, it's really kind of been fun to watch how this program has been moving into this new piece of agricultural management. It's always been a part of our mission, and we've done a lot of conservation easements, we've done some fee purchases, but with the glacier and salt install, and, you know, this new kind of community feel for local food and local production, it's really been kind of something that has just blossomed. And I really appreciate on our staff, we have Paul Holzinger, who's really been a big piece, and he's stepping up into this process to really help us manage our ag properties in a much more sustainable and proactive way. And so, you know, one of the things I just want to make sure, I want to hear some of the open space board members, because at the last meetings we had about Glacier, they started having some really strong thoughts on where we go with our ag program. So we just wanted to open it up for a discussion on our ag piece and see where, you know, and see, just check in with the BOCC. I think everything's good, but just to see if there's any other pieces of this that we should be looking at too.
I just want to say that I hugely excited by this. I think this is a really good sort of evidence of a maturing program. We're not reinventing the wheel here in that Boulder Open Space with 40,000 some odd acres of agricultural land has an operating lease program. This is patterned to some extent after theirs with our own twist to it here. But one of the impetus for me in going forward with this was to have, and I love the way this reflects the rest of Pitkin County's procurement process, in that it's that fair and open transparent process, so that these are not, so that agricultural deals on Pitkin County owned properties, nobody can come back after the fact and say, oh, that was a under the table handshake deal, that's not, that won't meet public transparency. So in terms of a maturing program, time is right to have an agricultural lease program and bid process in place. And we've been back and forth with staff on this, and it's been really fun seeing that come together at the Glacier. We're on the verge of adopting the Glacier management plan, and we sat at our, I guess, two meetings ago, and sort of looked at each other and said, what do you mean we're not like requiring this to be organic, or we need this to be a really strong statement for sustainability? That's that's our values. That's our aspirations here. We need this to, why doesn't this fully reflect our aspirations? And staff has come back and gotten more of our aspirations into these, into this document. So it's really great. We appreciate where we're going with it.
My question is what are we doing with current leases that are out there?
Well, current leases, you know, we're at the point where, you know, some of them are going to be expiring, and as soon as they expire, they're going to be under this lease bid process.
So when the term runs out, it'll go back to a formal bid process.
Correct.
Right.
And then, you know, also one of the pieces is Cozy Point Ranch is Cozy Point South. The county owns the piece on the other side. Those irrigation systems have been connected for a really long time. So that's one piece that we're going to really work very collaboratively with the city on how they're going to go in the future for Cozy Point Ranch, because it'd be very difficult to separate those two because of that shared pumped irrigation system. So, but that, other than that piece, you know, every other piece is going to go out to bid the same way that Glacier does.
Cool. This was driven to get it to this point with this date and in your hands, in part because of the Glacier management plan being the real test of this being the process that the identified seven ag parcels, some very small, some very large, will go through, so that the old system would phase out as the biggest fee-owned lands start coming in for ag operators. And when you see that management plan, Hawk made the comment that twice we've had meetings with the staff trying to aim higher, trying to get the management plan of the largest amount of irrigated acreage owned in fee to have high aspirations for how that is managed for wildlife, for ag, for recreation. And all the public that kept coming through were very pleased that they were heard, I guess you'd say. They were worried about pesticides or insecticides. They were worried about one thing or another, and the plan, when you see the draft, will reflect that.
George?
Two questions. One, so are you starting to see some inquiries? People are interested in applying?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, during the Glacier management plan process, you know, it was really, you know, exciting to see the level of ag interest. Will that relate into the amount of leases? I don't know yet, but we have, I mean, Paul has been working with, you know, not only ACES, but there's also a group of, you know, potentially smaller ag users that would like to do some type of co-op or something like that, and we've seen it. So, you know, there's also, you know, obviously Woody Creek Distillery that's very interested in potatoes, as we saw in Emma Open Space. And so, you know, we're starting to see smaller ag people that would like to lease these properties. So I think the interest is going to be there. I think we just got to start seeing what we get interest-wise. But I will not be surprised if we get, you know, a few applications and a few proposals from all of this, because, you know, from what we've heard from ACES, you know, they've been working really hard on their sustainable ag at Rock Bottom Ranch, Glacier installed where the Glacier Open Spaces. I mean, that's right next door. So it's an exciting time, but trying to set this up for it, I think we're going to get some interest, especially in the Mid-Valley pieces.
What are the deadlines for when people are going to submit their for Glacier, their proposals, and when those proposals are accepted? What are those two dates?
We're going to set that as soon, you know, we got to first get the plan approved and adopted. So once we get the initial piece adopted, the agricultural piece adopted in the management plan, which we're set to do potentially at our next meeting of open space, we set that, and then after that date, we can put them out to bid, and we'll set it at a certain period of time to allow them to have time to put that proposal in. It'll be just like we do procurement for our trail projects and everything else that we do. It's a procurement process. It's a set period of time, and you know, you have to, you follow our procurement process, and you look at our lease bid process, and you will then, you know, put in the dates. But that's all going to be set at when we release it.
But with a goal towards giving these guys enough time to get into the ground this spring. And that's what we want to do, correct? And do you think we can pick the bidder and make the lease in time for them to be, you know, get themselves organized to get in the ground?
Yeah, I think that once the lease has got to bid, I'm envisioning, you know, like 30 days, we'll have a mandatory on-site visit so people really understand what's on the property, and then give them, you know, a week or two to get their proposals in order, and then we'll turn around as quickly as possible so they can start planning.
Yeah, the goal is to, so they can get on that property in March, and so they can really get going. I mean, that's the goal, and from talking to the ag people, I mean, they want to get moving on that as soon as possible. And so that's why, you know, we're hoping, you know, with the ag piece at least, to get that approved and moved on. And, you know, we really, that's been kind of why we've been rushing Glacier a little bit, is because of that exact issue. We want to get the leases signed, done, and, you know, people on the ground, you know, in time to really do what they would need for a productive agricultural season.
Let me, with the leases or the bids that come in, how are we going to assess disturbance to the land and that sort of stuff? I mean, you know, going from grazing land or haying fields to potato fields is a big difference in terms of the disturbance in the land, not to mention any sort of co-op operation where you've got traffic going to and from, plotting out of those co-op areas, you know, all of that. It's, I mean, it kind of, it's a catch-22 with agriculture at 8,000 feet or 7,000 feet, and, you know, wanting to have a sustainable food production here up in the upper valley, which honestly is far and few between, and the old historic ranch lands that we've had of hay and horses and cattle?
So with opening this lands up to new possibilities, just like you said, things might get turned over, and so I'll probably be spending a lot of time out there monitoring continuously. Every year I'm going to meet with each lessee and develop an annual operating plan to make sure their plans for that year are going to be compatible with the conservation easement, the management plan, and just the sustainability and conservation of the property in general. And we'll consult with NRCS and the CSU Ag Extension Agent as we need. If there's things that we don't know or we need a little more expertise, we'll go to them. But we'll be continuously monitoring, making sure these things are working with all the other values that we're protecting it for, like wildlife and, you know, public access, that kind of thing.
And we have, you know, in that lease bid process, there's an evaluation criteria that we are going to work through on analyzing. And so, you know, like the potatoes on Emma this year, when we worked with, you know, Woody Creek Distilleries on their plan, there was never much of a time at all of when they put it right back to grass. They put it, they went right into potatoes. You know, it's all about the sustainability of the land, because you can't just let it go fallow, and you can't let it go to weeds and all that stuff. That's part
of a drought year when that happens, and, you know, forget it, you're destroying the land.
Right, well, and that's part of the deal is to make sure that the operational plan and the financial security that these, you know, operators have, that we don't let it go to that. And we do have a way to step in if it's not happening. And if that becomes a part of the issue, you know, we'll work on it. We're hoping, you know, we're hoping the evaluation criteria depicts the best agricultural practices at all. And, you know, one of the things that we're going to have to do is we're going to have to see, because some of these people are starting up. But, you know, as a startup, if somebody else comes in with a better plan, it's really going to be based on the best plan for the property and the most sustainable.
And is it the Open Space and Trail Board that makes final decision on which lease is picked?
The process is lease bids will come in to Open Space and Trails Department. We'll have a group of us in staff folks decide who we think would be the best candidate. And then when the lessee is decided and it comes down to signing the thing, it would go to BOCC for signature.
So it's a joint approval between, it doesn't sound like the Open Space and Trails Board was part of that at all. It was Open Space and Trails staff, and then it goes to the BOCC.
And I believe ComDev has a person on that.
ComDev does have a person, but it's basically, you know, basically right now the BOCC has to approve any leases.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we always want an Open Space Board recommendation on the lease. So that's going to be, you know, staff is going to bring it to the Open Space Board and then to you guys, because we always want a recommendation. It's not spelled out in here because we're still working on how we're going to do these leases.
Yeah.
But, you know, in the way we adopt things, the Open Space Board recommends to you a lease, and then you guys approve that lease.
I think that's
I'm wondering
a question. Sorry, go ahead.
If our board shouldn't see if we have a member who would be willing to consult with staff during that lease review process.
Well, the question we were just kind of talking about is the ensuring, and I'm not saying you haven't, but ensuring that ag experience is a key to the selection process based on the orientation of the land, the quality of the land, the availability of water, you know, all of those things, so that we have a success rather than a failure rate. The other thing that strikes me is that we're going to rely on the recommendation of this committee, right? I would think some lessee, potential lessees, would want a multiple year term in order to be able to invest what you need to invest to make the land suitable for their intended use. And yet, so I guess.
I think that's all in here, and that's a good
evaluation
part of it.
Criteria. Mm-hmm. Everything that you said between duration of the lease, the agricultural background, how does this piece fit in with your other agricultural?
I'm picking up on Rob's comment of whether it goes to the BOCC to approve the lease or whether it comes to us, that the actual evaluation, if you get several bids on each of these seven parcels that you've identified on Glacier based on where the infrastructure is, the roads, the ditches, you know, the homestead, et cetera, they go from about 3 acres to 140 or something like that. How is that assured that
there's ag experience?
That there's ag experience. It's just like when the county did the put together an ag committee for accessory agricultural buildings. It was so that people who had knowledge would be able to evaluate this. Is this really a loafing shed, or is this really a alternate use as soon as you stop watching?
Mm-hmm. So the committee that's created makes the recommendation. It goes to the Open Space Board to recommend to the BOCC. So, you know, it's just like our procurement for $1 million projects is we try to get a group of the most knowledgeable people together to make a recommendation on the proposal that best meets this criteria and everything else. So, you know, the hardest part is trying to create a bigger ag committee, is that hopefully those people are bidding potentially on some of this property. And so, you know, the way we do it is we look at all the evaluation criteria. And so the evaluation criteria has weighted pieces based on your experience. And so, you know, we're not going to recommend, you know, people with zero experience and zero ability to be on this piece of property. You're not going to see that. You're going to see, based on all this evaluation criteria, a recommendation come out as the best qualified people to lease these areas. So it's very similar to our procurement process right now, and that's how, you know, that's how we envision, that's why we put, you know, the CSU Ag Extension agent on there. He doesn't have any financial gain or thing on it, is to be part of this
selection
committee. And then there's two more steps to the piece of actually signing that lease. So there's a lot of checks and balances on that. I think we really need to just, let's see what we get. And, you know, and then we can evaluate and then potentially change the program if we're not getting what we think we're going to get. And we just don't need to lease pieces that don't meet these criteria. I mean, that's the goal. That's why we have the criteria, is to make sure that people on these pieces of land can do what they say they can do.
And I sort of interrupted your question, which was very specific about whether someone on this board.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Do you think one of us, not me, because I'm not that agriculturally knowledgeable, but I know a lot of you guys are, would anybody want to be in on that review process before it comes to us as a board? Guess not. Okay.
It's easier because you'll get to review it. You'll have a chance to review it.
We'll give you updates, you know, as we do.
Can I ask a timeline question? You've been receiving, we're in the 30-day public comment period on Glacier. It's almost up. Based on what's been coming in, do you think the adoption of Glacier, which has to happen in order for this to even get initiated by January and play out by March or April, is likely, based on what's come in during the comment period?
For the agricultural piece, we have seen very little or no comments on the agricultural piece.
So you're thinking
the biggest piece is going to be, you know, obviously what you've heard from a lot of people is the parking. And so we're going to work on, after the comment period, on, you know, some options there to figure it out, because we want to make sure the agricultural piece moves, because we didn't get the comment, and make sure that if we need more time on the parking, we can provide more time.
So it could be adopted in pieces, is what you're saying?
Or it could be adopted
or approved,
in,
but
yeah, it could
formally.
Be approved in either pieces, or it could be approved as an action item to continue to work on something else.
Okay.
Well, and then if you have anything else, I mean, one of the things that, you know, Graham's mentioned and a couple others is to give you guys a little time to have an open conversation about anything else you wanted to discuss. So staff didn't have anything else pressing at this moment.
Well, I guess we were looking, you know, for any comments from you guys, George.
Well, I know
any kind.
Tomorrow, actually, in our packet, we have a land use application coming before us regarding the music school campus. And it just, and part of that application, I don't know if I could probably say it's public, is they're actually looking at reducing the number of cars that they're going to allow on the campus, which is great. But that, for me, that sort of spurred the question, well, then maybe we need to revisit the idea of a safe egress for students. In fact, they're not going to allow students to drive to the campus at all. So if that's the case, which sounds reasonable, then we need to have that discussion again, how to have a safe egress from town, from the remote housing to the campus vis-a-vis a trail. And so I don't know if you guys have had any discussions on that at all, but I think that's probably something that we should be thinking about in the coming year or so.
Well, the good thing is Castle Creek Trail is back on our radar. We're gonna reopen the engineering and reopen the discussion. We're gonna work with the City of Aspen. And so we're gonna relook at the options that we have available through engineering, and, you know, hopefully bring that back for a project for 2016. And so, yes, it's something that is on our project management list, and it's going to be looked at again in 2015.
Somewhere on this, we don't know about it today, but it's on there.
It's on 2015.
Page 7 and 14 in Castle Creek.
And then, given, I haven't looked at the pack, but just in terms of time frame, given that that's going to be back on the list, and we still have sort of the ongoing work discussion on the Rio Grande Trail, how we're going to finish that surface. Where's the timeline now in terms of looking at the future extension of the Crystal River Valley Bike Trail?
Right now, we have that starting in 2016 is to start the, you know, all the feasibility studies and the biological studies. 2016.
Okay. Are they giving them this timeline?
They didn't get this timeline. This is usually just internal for us. I can give them. I can definitely get you guys our stewardship.
They're probably helpful, isn't it?
Yeah. But that, because that's a question, as you know, always comes up when I attend a caucus meeting up the Crystal. So that process won't even begin until 2016 at this point.
Correct. Yep. And that was based on, you know, trying to work on Castle Creek priority, and also, you know, looking at the Rio Grande, what other pieces we're going to work on that in 2015, surveying users and seeing where we go with that. And so, but in, you know, we're cognizant of that. We need to, the Crystal, eventually, we need to start moving on with that and looking at all the properties along the river in that area and how that would interact with the future trail and stuff.
But that timeline's largely driven by budget, too, right? I mean, we only have so much to spend on trails, and the Rio Grande was expensive.
Well, the repaving. You know, when we talk about the Crystal Trail, you know, we're talking a pretty large potential number on that. And so, you know, it's definitely going to be part of our reauthorization talk, is the pieces, what do we still have left? And, you know, trying to get a potential cost for something like that, you know, we really need to start doing the feasibility studies and start looking at the wildlife impacts and everything else. And then obviously, it's like a gorge project where we've got to really look at the entire piece, not just the trail. We've got to look at how it interacts with the river and everything else, and involve the community to an enormous degree, to because we promised that, but also because it works well when we involve the entire community into that discussion.
Just a suggestion. Building on Michael's suggestion that reauthorization look at allowing, by changing the charter, bicycle transit to occur on shoulders of roads and not be forbidden under the current charter. I think a joint meeting in the spring or the summer of this coming year, agenda item, so that it's a year ahead of when all the work happens, would be really time well spent on our list, which we've been keeping for years, and your list, which you can start thinking of, but that's one. Another one that came up with Glacier is, and it was the same with the Emma buildings, we can stabilize but not restore. That's a charter restriction. So you think about the buildings in the on the Glacier parcel. We can't do more than, like we did in Emma, make sure the roof doesn't collapse. So I just suggest that when we're planning joint meetings in the first half of 2015, we talk reauthorization. There's probably a list of 10 ideas that we have. Start getting interactive about that.
So we could bring that for a big agenda item. You know, we could do it in, I would say, probably the summer.
Yeah.
Or, you know, let's see. Well, I'll bring it back to the Open Space Board, and I'll work with John Peacock on trying to find a time, because I'm sure Michael had, obviously, one, and other BOCC members might have some.
Did you have an update on the SMART?
On what? Or SMART claims? No, basically we're going to work on getting maps and everything together for your next meeting,
should be.
So you can make some really good discussions on that.
And is there a time before that auction
will go?
Well, that's what Matt is talking with John Walla on, stuff like that.
We're in public.
Yeah, that's session. I think that's.
Thank you. All set.
Yeah. So other than that, I mean, basically, you know, it's the Glacier Management Plan has been the big one, and that's going to come up for adoption. And just to let the BOCC know that we are going to come back to you guys to, you know, discuss what was adopted, and then we go to Eagle County to get their adoption of that plan, because Eagle County has to adopt that plan to allow our rangers to do enforcement of any of the restrictions that are in the plans, and also allows the rangers to do some enforcement of Eagle County code on dogs and trespassing or anything other issues like that. So you guys will definitely see the Glacier plan again, and then we'll be working with your counterparts in the Eagle County BOCC. The good thing is the agricultural piece can continue to be leased, because there's nothing in that plan that is out of the Eagle County Code. Agriculture is completely allowed use in Eagle County Code. It's just about how we enforce is going to be the significant piece.
There's one other area that we're looking at and would be looking for collaboration with you guys on, and that is this historic structures. We do accumulate properties with historic structures on them. Townsite and Glacier, for example, and historic structures are not specifically a part of our mandate, and yet the properties are worth working on for open space and conservation values. And so I've been pushing for a board direction to staff in the realm of policy to come up with policies as to how to handle and address historic structures, whether that's retasking them or leasing them or outright, you know, subdivision for open space purposes and sale of those. You know, we need to get our hands around historical structures in Pitkin County. And again, this is not reinventing the wheel. We look to Boulder Open Space that has a very robust historic structure policy, which has included either long enough term leases or easement protection and resale to private individuals, and working with state funds to come up with restoration and reuse of these structures, which keep their historic elements alive to be appreciated, but more than just you know, fenced off, don't touch zones. We're needing to kind of get our heads and get the program around it, and if necessary, address it in a reauthorization expansion. So that's one area to consider going forward.
Anything else? Cool. Well, thank you.
Great job.
Thanks.
Do I hear a motion to go out of
cease and desist?
Cease and desist.
Certainly.
Mark, you're good.
I'll make that. I'll make that.
All right.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
And we will continue our meeting at 1:30. Welcome back, everyone. Today is December 2nd, 2014. This is the Board of County Commissioners Pitkin County work session, and we just had some meeting with Open Space and Trails, and now we're back for our afternoon agenda, starting with community development and environmental health fees.
I have Cindy.
Hi.
I'm
Suge. Would you We brought the team. I'm Cindy Hubin with Community Development. I'm the Community Development Director. And Community Development, as everybody remembers, is planning, building, and zoning and environmental health. And we're before you today based on some background that, if you recall, we had some changes to the valuation process for the building permit fees a couple years ago, and we told the board we would be back looking at fees again. We had previously talked to the board earlier in the budgeting process this year about bringing back some minor adjustments to our fee schedules, and then coming back in 2015 with a broader look at the entire fee schedule with the building department, which is really where the meat of the building permit costs are. And so today we're before you basically with a couple ordinances to talk about more minor, if you will, increases in our fee schedule for community development. And then there's a separate resolution for environmental health. If you recall, environmental health, a lot of those fees are driven by state statute, and we just want to keep current with those, with our fee schedule, so that the public really knows the true cost when they come in the door. But I'd first like to back up a little bit and explain what we are trying to do as a group, and maybe really quickly just give a round of introductions. Because you may not know everybody, but you of course know Kurt Dahl, our environmental health director, you know Brian Paul, our chief building official. Anne Marie Prince is our business analyst, who is working with us on our all our computer systems and does a great deal of our analysis when it comes to the budget. We have Carla Cahill, who you have not met, who is our new admin assistant, who will be doing the day-to-day budget work in our office. as well as Lance Clark, our Assistant Community Development Director and Planning Director. So together we have all spilled over, if you will, all of the budgeting for community development. And I think under John's supervision, we're just getting better and better at kind of anticipating some of our needs. And we have sat down on like a 5-year work program analysis of where we're going and what we might need in the future. And happy to share some of that with you at a later date. But today, the purpose of the meeting is to really go over this, what we call more minor adjustments to the community development fee schedule. And with that, I want to tell you that we have been working with finance, and because the building is escalating at this point, we had a couple different goals in mind.
Cindy, when you say the building is escalating, what?
Building permits and fees. So we are no longer in a depressed state as far as the building economy in Pickens County. We're up in revenue significantly, and we look like we are going to surpass our budgeted estimate for 2014 significantly, to the tune of probably around $462,000 or even a little bit greater. So I want to point out we're not in a huge crisis mode right now in 2014 as far as the budget's concerned, but we want to also let you look at over time, and our goal here is to try to create a system where we are sustaining what the board wants us to sustain as far as our operations and the cost of our operations. So if you look at our department over time, since Environmental Health joined our group in 2009, you know, we've had ups and downs, but the general fund over a running total for that 7 years has subsidized community development to the tune of about $2.7 million. So it's, even though this year looks like we're healthy, we all know those years when you were subsidizing even a smaller staff at that point to the tune of, you know, over $1 million.
And this is over what years?
2009 to what we're looking at.
So during the greatest recession since the Great Recession.
Yes.
So we'll make that clear.
Yeah, exactly. And in past discussions, we've talked about the board's comfort level with a subsidy. And over time, the discussion has always been, does development pay its own way? And if development pays its own way, and we subtract out the long range portion of community development, which is a portion of my time, a portion of other people's time, obviously Ellen's time, you know, we take that aside, then what levels of subsidy, you know, really is the board comfortable with for community development? You know, in way past, people were like, zero. You know, the board was like, no subsidy. Development pays its own way. That's the goal. And in more recent years, there's been more discussion about that. What should it really be? So we are here today, quite frankly, in a comfortable position this year to really sit back and look at this. And so we have some alternatives. We may, if you feel that our arguments are strong enough to move on today, we'd love you to entertain our two ordinances tomorrow at your regular meeting and move those along. But if not, you may like the alternative of us coming back with a bigger picture, because there are some things that, some considerations, and this gets really big, so I'm going to try to narrow it down to the pros and cons of looking at what we have before you today. Today, as we said, it's more of a minor adjustment, and it focuses more on the hourly tasks versus a percentage task, like what's your percentage cost for a building permit fee and evaluation, and gets into the more complicated look. Today, we really focused primarily on things that were woefully outdated given the practices today, given our referral fees that we charge so that other departments can do their work, and also the hourly tasks that we do. And so I'll try to explain a little bit of that and walk you through a little bit of what we're looking at. When we look at the community development, planning, zoning, and referral fees, community development today in the planning department is at $312 per hour generalized fee, and we're asking to go up to the $325. That is about, I want to say, a 4% increase over the last 9 years. We haven't increased that fee at all. So we think that that's in keeping with what we're looking at as far as the workload, and don't think that that's too big of a jump to expect much feedback on. As far as the zoning issues, this is where we look at some things that we haven't looked at in years and years, at least back to 2009 and probably a lot earlier, where when we look at a permit from the zoning person's perspective, they look at a lot. They look at the square footages, they look at the heights, they look at a number of issues. But we've really gotten much more sophisticated in our zoning over the last, I'd say, 7 years, where zoning is compliance out in the field. So we have people that go out, inspect compliance with the planning issues. Has someone actually done their wildfire mitigation before we give them their certificate of occupancy? Has someone really met their requirements as far as overhangs and heights and setbacks and all of the zoning types of issues, as well as kind of tied into all of that is our much more thorough, if you will, engineering type review of applications. And so we've got sort of an in-house paperwork and an outside inspection type of look. So I'd say we're doing a lot more thorough job in the zoning, and we were still charging, I think it was 14, starting with 14 cents a square foot, and it was on a sliding scale. So we're asking to obviously shift that scale and look at a more realistic hourly kind of percentage there. For residential and non-residential applications. And then quickly...
Cindy, can I ask a question?
Yeah,
okay. I think I'm on the same page as you on the zoning.
Mm-hmm.
So the fees that are in this chart, they are what you're suggesting we go at, but
yes,
it doesn't show what the fees were.
Yeah.
We do have a comparison, and we can...
Or at least a percentage increase.
Yeah. Well, that's the one tricky one, because it was a sliding scale. It wasn't because it ratcheted up when you had these different square footage levels. You see that you go 2,500 square foot to 5,000 square feet is a certain fee, and then you go from the 5,001 square feet up to the 10,000 square feet. So there's not a really good percentage.
Okay.
And I'm trying to remember, though, the extremes of, do you remember the extremes of the 14 cents per square foot up to?
Went up to about 35, I think.
35 cents a square foot. And so.
So you're looking at the exhibit on the ordinance.
Yes, and that would be.
And so this is in the ordinance in the very
page
back
eight.
Of our very mm-hmm. back of our packet. Page eight. Starts on page 8 of the ordinance, or of the second agenda item, because there are two agenda items.
Correct. So here we're going with the 40 cents.
Yeah.
up to the 80 cents.
But I guess, I mean, I had the same question reading through this last night too, and mm-hmm. what George is asking is, mm-hmm. you know, where's the red line version of what exists? Where's the current code of what exists? So mm-hmm. we can look mm-hmm. individually at various things and say, all right, well, this thing went up a buck, this went up, you know, $2, as right. opposed to just an ordinance that says, here are the new things, and there's, in your memo, you've got some examples. Mm-hmm. You point
right.
out three,
right.
and they're probably, well, there's 7 pages of mm-hmm. 20 fees per page, so I don't know what else has changed.
I tried to give you that.
2009, this is our current ordinance.
That's what we need.
Okay, and you haven't had time to really
look at that.
But what I try to do is give you the highlights, and maybe I should back up a minute and say, with all the changes embodied in these two ordinances, we estimate on today's, you know, activity that this would garner about an additional $100,000 with all of the fee changes. If we had the same permits come in under the new fees versus the old fees, it would increase the budget by about $100,000. We're not talking huge changes, but if you want to know the individual changes, you know, I do have those comparisons.
Well, I think it's important for us to look at the individual changes.
Mm-hmm.
And then to the $100,000 number, I think the big question that I had is, I think it's important to look at the budget as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
and what it looks like with the $100,000 increase.
Right.
You know, it's much like the waste management, the landfill, where there are all these departments, and mm-hmm. one department subsidizes another a little mm-hmm. bit, because that's the policy that was set forward with the board.
Right.
You know, like the general fund subsidizing ComDed is the policy that was set forth by the board, or mm-hmm. or at least the way we dealt with the shortfalls. But I think it's important to make a decision on an ordinance like this to be able to look at the revenues coming in mm-hmm. and the expenses going out versus department before and after a change like this, and what that means to the overall budget. You know, you also mentioned that, you know, in the budget of ComDev, you've got you know, long-term planning, and you know, how much of that. You know, you said there was a mm-hmm. $2+ million subsidy over the last 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
Very depressed last 7 years, I would add to that.
But not the last three. We've thrown money into the pot the last mm-hmm. three.
Well, you throw money into the pot the last three, and it looks like at least it's going that way for the next, you know, couple of years, unless there's another, you know, something that happens.
Mm-hmm.
But how much of that has gone to support our long-term planning, which is really policy decision stuff, not really mm-hmm. fee-based stuff, mm-hmm. in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, charging someone a fee to support what we need to be doing as a government as a whole. So seeing that big picture, I think, is crucial in this as well.
And I can give you those numbers, you know, generally, if you're interested, like the overall budget with ComDev, we figure with salaries and special project costs, you know, we're probably looking at about $225,000 for long range.
Yeah.
Out of the entire budget. But I understand you'd like to see it
yeah.
all in front of you. And we can make that happen. I think if we stay maybe at the bigger level instead of, I was just trying to point out the highlights of where this was going to take us. And we feel like we know that zoning is the biggest jump in the fees because they have been so low over the years. And so, you know, that you just pointed out the biggest. We used to start off with $149 as the base, and now we're going to $175 as the minimum base, and then it goes from starting off with a 14 cents per square foot at a 40 cent per square foot up to an 80 cents per square foot versus up to a 40 cent per square feet. So,
yeah.
you know, on an individual, it just depends on your the size of your project, what that might cost you. So it's a little bit difficult to say.
And I'm all for, you know,
whether you call it cost of living increases or the cost of doing the work that you guys do increases. But those numbers mean nothing to me unless I have the big picture. Mm-hmm. You know, in our budget packet, we've got, you know, expenditures of $1.4 million in planning and zoning. And then it's the revenue that supports it is basically the information in our budget packet says 29% of that is from P&Z revenues, the other is ComDev revenues, but it doesn't really break down what those are and how this would be affected by these changes. Mm-hmm. It's just, in reading this memo, it was very hard to make any educated decision in any direction without all those pieces. I mean, if you tell me, yeah, the city charges more, and we haven't raised our fees, and I want to raise my fees, to me, that's not a way to make a decision. A way to make a decision is how does the budget work, and what's the bottom line? Because mm-hmm. there's a point where it becomes a net positive, mm-hmm. and we start to say, well, okay, are we funding money back to the general fund to, you know, pay for something discretionary, pay for the bike race, or pay for, you know, which money comes out of our general fund to pay for special events in the way of helping the bike race. And I'm not sure that that's the proper way to look at it either.
Well, I don't know how much more you want to go on with this conversation without that information, but I could back up here and say, with all of us, you know, spilling over these numbers, and I look at just the last 3 years of additional revenues that will go into the general fund, I can argue that, in fact, you know, it's pretty close to the reality of running the department, because if I look at the $462,000 that theoretically will be put into the general fund based on 2014's end of year revenues, I could really argue that we, from a cost center perspective, which is the way the county looks at my costs of using your time, community development's cost of using your time, community development's cost of using John's time, or John Ely's time, or building facilities. There are certain things that aren't included in this number that would deduct that. And just today, very roughly, because of the swap in space, we have not really been included in that cost center for the cost of our space. So when community development really has to look at what we would pay for our space needs, we are looking probably at deducting another $150,000 from this on an annual basis. So right there, you know, you're looking at a chunk. And if I looked at the fact that you have asked me to keep at a certain type of turnaround time from a service level perspective, I could argue, you know, we met that this past year because you thankfully gave us a couple new folks and we've been doing great in that regard. But because we continue to see an upswing, and because I could go back and look at my overtime costs, which are included here, I could argue that I really need a couple more people to keep at those service levels. So when I really look at it, I think, wow, it looks like you got a lot of money going into the general fund from community development right now. But I could argue that down probably to about, you know, less than $100,000 range that would go back into the general fund. So I would say that the goal of this conversation and where we're trying to go is to bring us to a level where we're evening out the service level expectations by you as a board, as well as what subsidies you feel are acceptable. And the work that we've done is to try to keep those parameters in mind. And so rather than bring you the whole comprehensive look with the building permit fee schedule, we decided to bring you these more incremental changes to what we saw were either just flat out wrong or very low and hadn't been adjusted, you know, in years and years and years, or where other departments may be hurting on their hourly tasks because we aren't getting them the referral fees that we should be getting them based on their needs. We decided to come to you with this more incremental approach, which is small in relative to the big picture of potentially garnering about another 100 to 112, I think is what we estimated, $1,000 per year, and come back to you with a larger fee schedule. And another reason behind holding back on that larger fee schedule is because once we shore up what we think are the sustainable task-oriented hourly wage kind of compensation look, we can come back to you and say, you know what, we may be able to reduce building permit fees, especially where you've asked us to. In the 250,000 and below range for the smaller projects, you have consistently over the last couple of years asked us to come back and look at that. We said, okay, but first let's see how we're doing with our valuations. If that in fact is doing what we think it's going to do when we make our valuations more true than they had been in the past, and we're seeing yes, our valuation fees over the last couple of years, if I can find this one sheet, we were looking at in 2012 about a $326 per square foot average on our valuation fees. When we started implementing, getting a little better with all of that, in 2013 we got to about $512 average, and today we're at about $563 a square foot. So we are definitely scrutinizing all the building permits that come in, and that's an average, you know, that's taking in everything. So we're definitely charging the true costs versus what we used to and not pay as much attention to that valuation. So that's making us feel more comfortable. If we're more comfortable with the hourly tasks, another example is that on some of our sub-permits, like mechanical and electrical, we were charging one fee was like $9 and something, and we were charging, and that we can't really even get out the door to inspect, you know, for $9. So we're trying to shore that up just to, you know, pretty much cover the true costs of what it would take to even inspect one inspection on a small electrical or mechanical project. So we've gone up to more of an average, I think, I said it in the cover memo, I can't remember now, but we've come up to
29.75.
Yeah, a little bit. And that obviously doesn't cover the cost, even to start the truck and drive to Redstone or drive to the frying pan and look at a plumbing or an electrical inspection. But we felt like that jump was significant, and so we were holding it there for now. When we come back to you, my hope is with the bigger picture, if we have what we feel is a solid base for our hourly types of expenses, then we can really take a greater look at the fee schedule revenue. And the hope is that $250,000 range and below for a permit, if I came in for a small addition, could actually have a lower rate associated with it than they have today, because
that's the next step, right?
That's our next step.
Yeah.
And I totally understand if you need to see that comprehensive picture altogether. We were just trying to begin the year in 2015 with what we felt was the sustainable base for our more hourly types of charges. Right now, at $80 an hour for a change order, someone might bring in, you know, a change order to a larger home that could take us, you know, a day to look at a change order, or maybe even more.
What's your billing per hour?
$80.
Oh, it's a flat fee.
And we're asking that be increased to the 250 range, because that covers the cost of doing that. You also have to remember, I mean, and I'm sorry to throw all this at you, but you also have to remember that when we take in a building permit fee, we are committed from a labor perspective for at least the next 2.5 years, because I did a little quick average of what it takes to build a house in Pickens County. 2.4 years is kind of the average. So we're committed from a labor perspective to inspect that permit for the next 2.5 years. We're not, we may be taking in the fee in now, but we're actually doing the work maybe as far as 2.5 years out. So my attempt here with the sustainability, if you will, kind of approach is that if it all tanked tomorrow, you know, we're charging a fee that would allow us to sustain what our needs are to get the job done, because we took someone's money in 2.5 years ago, that sort of thing. So you have to realize that we have this kind of game going here with a little bit of, we have to project out that we are on the hook for our labor at least that far out. We can't say, okay, all building inspectors go home when we've got open permits.
And just trying to understand the process, when a building, you know, a house gets built or whatever, and they come through all this, mm-hmm. there's not just one of these fees they pay.
No.
They pay a lot of these fees. And some of them are fees up front,
right.
like, you know, a square footage fee, several thousand dollars or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, that's a submittal fee, and it's, mm-hmm. you know, $3,000, mm-hmm. whatever it might be.
Right.
And then there's, you know, that's submittal, you get the money, and then there's a fee for an inspection where you're getting paid, you know, a minimal amount to go inspect it, but you've already got that other fee that helps subsidize that inspection.
Actually, the way the number one building permit works is that we take it all up front. We basically take an estimation of a 65% of the cost up front. And then when someone picks it up at the end, they pay the impact fees for the other associated things like road mm-hmm. impact fees, housing impact fees, REMP, renewable energy mitigation fee, things like that are then paid when a permit issues, actually goes out the door so that the contractor can start on the project. We don't charge an extra inspection fee. Only separately or standalone are the sub-permits, like mechanical, electrical, plumbing.
Those fees are all paid up front, too.
So but they're,
paid up front. The point, it's not so much when they're paid that I'm sure. concerned. Okay. What I'm curious about is that one fee only requires an hour, and you get paid $500 for it. And then another fee that's added to it is you get paid $9, and it requires 3 hours. But they balance each other out, is my point. They balance each other out because you've got a positive balance in your account right now of $460,000. So there's, you know.
I would argue we don't, but yeah.
So to some extent, mm-hmm. you know, they're offsetting each other, what I'm saying. The money goes into the same ComDev revenue, and it goes out as an expenditure through labor or facilities. And those are like the facility thing that you mentioned. I mean, that's a great argument. You made a lot of great arguments. I wanted to hear you continue to talk, but the arguments aren't in this packet. And the bigger picture is not in this packet. So understanding that bigger picture to me is crucial on making budgetary decisions like this. That's just me.
And that's that argument about the building permit covering some of the costs of the plumbing inspection, that works on a combined building that has the plumbing permit tied to it, but we were looking at bumping those fees for the standalones as well, and that's where we're kind of losing the money on the plumbing and the mechanical sure. fees, is because those fees are so low. They work, sure, with their conjunction with a building permit that's covering some of those costs, but if it's standalone, all the guy's doing is doing plumbing-related inspections on a plumbing permit, those numbers are way low.
And I understand that where you can make a specific argument on a standalone, but that's not all that's proposed here before us. You know, there's a lot of other stuff proposed here for us. Just like the landfill, recycling is subsidized by tipping fees because we want to have a recycling program in our community. I mean, that's the way some of our budgetary stuff works.
Yeah, Rob, if I could interject, because I wonder if a more a better use of your time would be maybe getting some feedback from the board about what a fee schedule should look like, what qualities it should have. In other words, if we do want to subsidize long-range planning, we probably should put that stake in the ground now, so that we have a better idea how to bring this back to you. The rational nexus for what ComDev has brought in terms of the limited picture is that a number of these fees haven't been adjusted since the mid-90s or late 2000s. And so what we do know for a fact is that the majority of what community development does is service, and so it's people, and we know those costs have continued to go up, and in many cases it's been more than a decade since any of the fees have been adjusted. And so that subsidy that we're talking about isn't necessarily a real strategy. It's just how it's happened to work out over time. And we're lucky when we've got a big bump in activity, and then when we have a downturn in activity. We haven't really spent time historically, which is not uncommon for a lot of public sector organizations, looking at our fee schedules. And so then we get to the point that when we have to adjust them, it looks like these huge jumps. And so one of the things that I think we need to be looking at is how do we make more regular adjustments with a rational nexus that makes sense to the board? Because right now I think we're trying to figure out what it looks like, and it's been so long since we've adjusted these. There's no longer a rational nexus between those things. So it might be a better use of our time to get some feedback. What do you want it to look like?
Rob.
Yes, Michael.
So I agree with a cost-based fee structure. Mm-hmm. That's essentially what we're asking for here. That's good. You know, the problem of not raising your fees for 10 plus years, that's a fault.
That's huge.
Mm-hmm. So we should agree with a cost-based fee structure, but we have to review it on an annual basis. You know, RAFTA, if they raise their fares, they have a drop-off in ridership.
Mm-hmm.
If we raise our fares, I don't think we're going to have a drop-off in applications. And the main justification to the public is that we have to have a fee structure that's commensurate with the work that we do. Mm-hmm. And that's understandable to everyone, because that's how they pay their lawyer fees and some would argue their doctor fees, everything. So that's fine, but to wait 10 years and do it, that's not good. And RAFTA reviews their fares on an annual basis, and they deal with it because it's a market-based thing. Mm-hmm. So let's get on that. Let's do that. This is very complicated. And it's very complicated. Mm-hmm. And I agree with Rob in terms of looking at the larger picture to understand it better. But I think from just a policy point of view, cost-based fee structure is fine with me.
George? So these proposed fare changes, are they reflected in the 2015 budget?
You know, our 2015 budget, even without these adjustments, I believe we will make those budget numbers, because our base is starting so much higher than we projected when we started coming in. And so in terms of pressure to make budget right now, that is not our pressure. We are trying to bring this and to Michael's point about trying to get this on a more annual basis, one of the things I've been asking departments that charge fees and probably put ComDev in this position kind of quickly is to say, look, the fee discussion should come with our budget each year, so that we're having this discussion, we get used to this discussion, and it's not, because it is a lot. I mean, there's a lot of lines here. It's complex. And because we don't visit it very often, we're not very familiar with it. So, George, in terms of having pressure to do this right now, it would not necessarily affect our estimates for 2015 budget. Now, long term, what Cindy was talking about in terms of sustainability, I do think it's important that we get our fee schedule straightened out, that we have it on a true cost basis. And one of the things we may want to consider, you know, along the lines of your question, is we have two fee resolutions in front of you. One is for the planning and zoning fees, which are the complicated ones that we've been talking about. The other is for environmental health, which is really matching up the fee schedule more to the recent changes that we made in our inspection policy, as well as what state statute allows us to do. And just listening to the conversation and how much more background it sounds like we probably need to give, one suggestion I might make for you to consider is let's look at going ahead and making the adjustment to the environmental health fees, because I do think that's a clearer picture now with the budget. And maybe we need to back up based on this discussion on the planning and zoning fees to bring back more of that full picture and data. I think this is a good discussion to get the wheels turning about how complex it is and get some feedback about how you guys would like to see that structured, so that when we bring that full picture back, we can be sure that we present it in a way that is meaningful to you from a policy perspective and will make sense to all of us, because it is complicated.
Yeah, you've got dozens of line items here, which is pretty extraordinary when you start to look at all the different variations and opportunities. And so, dissimilar to when we look at the landfill, mm-hmm. and when they come in for an ask for a fee increase for whatever, it's much, much more consolidated. But with that, where their request comes, an explanation of mm-hmm. Current expenses, competitive. Competitors in terms of what they're charging to justify. But here it's so many different fee structures, it is a little more complicated. And for me, it was just sort of a basic question. And I, when you first started out, you said, well, your primary change is an hourly fee increase from 312 to 325, mm-hmm. a 4% increase over 6 years. Well, that's easy to understand. But without the context in terms of what the fees were and what you're looking at now, it's hard for me to understand.
So we would include the existing fee schedule, obviously.
And then you show some examples in terms of comparing with the city fees, which are great. And I don't know if it's relevant. It probably is not relevant to look at other counties, because they're just not dealing with the valuation of real estate that we're dealing with.
Yeah. No, I think, and even from a city to a county, our operational expenses are so different. Mm-hmm. You know, we go to the hinterlands to inspect a new faucet, you know, versus, a more compact jurisdiction. The city has probably twice as many employees in their community development department as we do, so we don't have the same overhead. So it's a tough comparison, and we're not trying to make that. We're just trying to come up with that cost basis approach, and it is a little more complicated in the sense that by staging it, our hope was that we could, what we would feel is, get the foundational, what we thought were easy adjustments, minor adjustments made, in order to come back with what was, we think, more substantive to the public, as far as when I walk in the door, what is my cumulative figure for the cost of my building permit. And what we're hoping to do is say, for the smaller permits, it's not going to cost as much. But we totally understand it's complicated, and you want, and I agree totally that it, it isn't a good thing to wait. I think that with the downturn, there was a sentiment that, you know, we weren't going to be raising fees, and we probably should have just kept it in front of everybody over these last at least 5 or 6 years anyway.
And I don't want to procrastinate this either. I mean, it'd be good to have this information come before us relatively soon, so then we can move forward, because we are in a building boom, and we should be able to have those resources to take care of that.
And that's,
I wanted to just add to that, the part that we came forward with now, the reason why we're holding off on the rest of it, which would be really taking a closer look at those valuations and the building reviews, is because we're entering into this new software. And so we're hoping to go live sometime in the beginning with the building stuff, the beginning of 2015. So that could totally change our workload. And obviously, in the beginning, it's going to be more workload because we're learning the system, but we also have to give it some time to shake down. But having this electronic plans review, we're not sure how this, I mean, a lot of times they mark up two sets of plans, and in a lot of situations, they will only need to do one. So we're having trouble right now nailing those numbers because we're trying to really relate this back to an actual workload that we're not 100% sure where that's going to land yet. So it's sort of a work in progress. So this was sort of the first half of looking at fees that we know we haven't touched in a long time, trying to bring them up a little more in line, because even if we give a reduction, it probably won't be there because those fees are just so woefully behind the workload that's attached to that. But where valuations have increased our fee structure for building, that's where we'd be looking at possibly lowering that if when we look at workload, we actually can't do this at the fee levels that are coming in now and maybe even lower them.
And for me, at least for me, it may be as simple as doing this this part of the work session even next Tuesday at the next work session to have that information and then be able to go forward. But I don't know if that's in terms of what your, I mean, it's simple in terms of what your costs are currently and what you're looking at an increase. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure it's going to be reasonable, but it's just be nice to, mm-hmm. to have that information.
No. A substantial amount of that's already done that we were trying to synthesize for you.
Yeah.
But if you would like to look at all of our spreadsheets, we're happy to share them because, I mean, it would show you a better picture.
You know, Cindy, it's not all of our spreadsheets. It's information that we can use because when somebody comes into your office, they don't really argue with you about your fees. I mean, they may be unhappy with them, but they know you're not going to change their fees. Mm-hmm. You don't have the power to do that. You don't say, well, I like you a lot, and,
right.
and you come in here a lot, and I'll give you a discount. you just can't do that.
Yeah.
On our part, people say, why do I get charged so much for building fees? And I have to be able to give the public a justification mm-hmm. for those fees.
Sure.
And if I can give them a justification of, we're trying to associate those fees with the costs that we incur processing those fees, that helps me explain it in a way that's direct and simple, because I'm not going to drag out those spreadsheets to
no and that's exactly what we're trying
to say, well, look at this, see on this and then we add this, and of course we have something we can't factor in here, long-term plan. I can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
So it has to be fairly direct, and in terms of dragging all those spreadsheets out, we're just asking for, and quite frankly I'd be happy with just some examples of how it works through the cost, from starting with past costs, present costs, and costs that you're incurring presently. So let's not make it overly complicated. This was overly complicated, but that's my feeling.
Yeah. But could I? And I'm going to look at your staff because I know we have multiple projects going on. So Anne-Marie, I need eye contact in particular. Because I know you have CCI and such, CSI, I'm sorry. So George, I'm wondering if we actually came back with a work session that really looked at all the fees based on the information we have now in the February timeframe. That won't give us a long run with CSI, I know, but it will give us a run on what we know now with the costs, and we can come back with a fuller picture. Does that?
I think we've run a lot of the numbers in the background. I don't think I'll have time to be in the Mayo building, but if you're just talking about the stuff we came forward with today, I could condense and just do some highlights from that, and I think what we've gotten from Connie from the budget numbers, we could also pull that into it. So we could have that even sooner.
So how
but
quickly?
As far as a more elaborate picture in February, I don't know that I would
okay.
have time.
Okay, and that's why I wanted to know, because if we could do a full picture, I'd say let's come back at the beginning of next year, but maybe we come back with a fuller picture with the information that's asked today on just these fees. When could we do that by?
We could, it depends on, because I probably need some Connie's and John's help mm-hmm. for the financial side of it, so it ties into the current budget picture you guys are looking at. So if they have time to work on that piece of it, I should be able to buy next Tuesday.
Okay.
If you want to slide it into that.
Well, why don't we come back next Tuesday and try and reframe the picture on these. It means that those fees won't get adopted. We'll pull them from tomorrow's agenda, so they won't get adopted with the budget, but we'll be able to do a first reading by budget and probably handle them in the first regular meeting in January. Whatever you guys give us direction on, and then we can work on the bigger picture of the building permit fees with the implementation of the new software and understanding how that shifts our workload, as well as how we're calculating values has shifted a lot. And that's why we don't want to do a full reset right now until we understand how those, until we have an actual cost basis to set them on. So does that work for the board on the planning and zoning fees, Rosette? Do you think we'll be able to address your concerns?
Yeah, I mean, for me, again, it's about having the big picture of how the department works as a budgetary piece of the entire budget and how these fee changes work into that. From there, my suggestion would be, you know, take smaller bites of the apple. You know, look at, instead of having, you know, 10 pages of lists and lists of fee, you know, if you had come to me today with an ordinance that said a plumbing inspection, we're charging, you know, $9 and it takes, you know, a standalone plumbing inspection and it takes an average of 5 hours and their overhead cost to that, I wouldn't bat an eye at raising that fee to $325 or whatever number, you know, a number that you came with some logic to, because I would say that's the cost. But so
we're sorry this is so complicated. What we tried to do is have the entire ordinance in front of you.
Yeah.
So you would see all the fees. Not every one of these fees is changing.
Well, in a, and we can't see that in here.
Right.
That's the problem.
That's a problem.
You know, because you just list a couple of examples and then you say, you know, other things are changing.
What I
so it's that, being able to see what each thing's changing and why you're justifying that change. And then the bigger picture of how, you know, the policy decision here is how the department runs budgetarily. You know, like you said, a $2 million subsidy over the last 7 years, well, how much of that is long-term planning? You know, how much of that is other things? How much of that is the facility cost that's not worked in there? Those sorts of things.
So that may be a little bit harder to pull together and project on the big picture. So if we're going on a cost basis, that's easier for us to piece together on the individuals. We can do a high level overview like you're saying, Rob, but it may not satisfy everything you're asking for.
So let me just say real quickly, I mean, the cost basis is great, but I still also agree with the policy of, just like we're talking about smaller houses getting a little cheaper, bigger houses paying a little bit more of the bigger bill when they're burdened by that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's the people that come to me that say, you know, I can't believe the building fees about this. It's not the person that works on Wall Street and is building a $10 million house. It's the person that's got a $500,000 house. They're struggling to make their mortgage all the time, and they want to put in new windows or something or change the plumbing. That's the person that comes to me and says, oh my God, I can't deal with all these fees and fees. You know, so I'm not talking about protecting,
you know, the mega mansion person. I'm talking about these fees are going to affect people that are residents here that are having trouble doing those sorts of things. So that's where the bigger picture comes in terms of not everything is cost driven. Mm-hmm. One thing has got to subsidize a little thing, and there's some interesting balancing with the policy on how we make that happen to make it a livable community. Anyway, so it's to me, I would take the big picture and I'd bring back little bites of the apple and reviewing the bigger picture as you're doing that. That's would be my suggestion, but it is longer than next week, so
potentially.
I would go the other way around.
Well, that's what I was hearing. That's why I wanted to bring it up.
The other way around. I think it'd be just if I could just look at knowing that the fees haven't been increased in years, and knowing that our costs have gone up, that we can't subsidize everything. I just want to see an explanation of current fees, proposed fees, and how that impacts a budget. And then we can have this bigger picture next year as well. As Michael said, we should be having an annual review of this, and that way it won't be as onerous as this is today.
We'll do our best to accommodate, you know, the information-wise, both requests. But as far as saying the fees, we're gonna have to choose one or the other, so.
And then what you're suggesting, John, is we can also, now we can look at the environmental side, because
that's where I was just going to go, because we've spent all our time right now on planning and zoning, and quite frankly, I think we've got some extra time to spend. I don't think our next section of our agenda is going to take the full hour. But I do want us to talk a little bit about the environmental health fees, because I think the nexus there is just a lot simpler, plus there are fewer lines.
Their budget's really small.
Yeah. So the environmental health fees, what I'm proposing actually is clarification of one of the fees, and then two new permit fees. The fees that we're charging for our two main programs, food and septic, those are set in state statute, and we're not able to change those fees. The food program is probably covered about 40% by fees, 60% of that is subsidized. And the septic program is probably about 50-50 in terms of subsidization and coverage of fees. So the fee that I am clarifying is the use permit fee. The issue that we've run into is we've been charging a single fee for a property, but sometimes we have properties that have multiple septic systems on those properties. In reality, we're issuing, in some cases, 3, 4, and 5 permits on a property and charging a single $100 fee for that, even though we're doing the work just like we would for one system. So I'm clarifying that it's $100 per permit, not $100 per piece of property when you sell that property. So we should be paid for that work as well. And in my opinion, we're giving away free permits when we do that. So the other two, the permits that I'm proposing that are new, one is the renewable permit. That permit was created when we adopted the 2014 regulations. Setting that fee at $100, which is the same as the use permit fee, again, based off of what Anne-Marie was talking about, that's just a estimate of where our time will be, and I think we'll come back in the summer, actually look at amount of time spent on that, and then actually try to do a better job of recovering our costs with that fee. But I anticipate the amount of work will be about the same as the use permit. The other fee is what I'm calling a minor repair permit. We already issue repair permits. One of the things we do not do, however, is capture small repairs, like pipe repairs, like replacing a pump in a tank. Those things get repaired and replaced, and we actually don't even know that that happens. That's something through our use permit program, it's become very evident that we need to at least capture that information that those repairs are going on, that people are properly sizing the pumps based on what the engineer spec'd originally, that if pipe is being replaced, you know, what's it being replaced with, who's the contractor, just some very basic information that we don't have now that would be very useful, because we've done some head scratching with our use permit program where we've had some of these minor repairs and no evidence what happened. So we want to capture that information, but I also recognize that a lot of times some of these repairs are done in an emergency. You know, it's Christmas Eve, the pipe just broke, I need to get the repair done now. So what I would like to do is, once we roll out CSI, I actually want to be able to just submit that electronically and actually just capture the information electronically, so that we aren't holding people up in an emergency repair, that they can get that done and they're not waiting for us either over a weekend or a holiday to actually wait for that permit. Because I want to use CSI, the other pieces at this point, I want to set that fee even less than the use permit fee of $50, because I'm looking at minimizing staff time and really only looking at reviewing a permit fee and then capturing information. So, but again, that's something that we would come back in the summer based on what our time was and look at an actual cost recovery. But I felt like that would be less than even what a use permit is right now. So that was the driving goal for setting a $50 fee for that piece.
Rob?
Yep, Michael.
So who calls you and says, I've got an emergency with my septic system? I mean, the reality is people fix their septic systems and go on.
Right. But what I want to do is actually at least capture that information. If it's a major repair, they have to get a permit from us. So if your leach field fails, if your tank fails, those require a permit from us already, and we issue those. The pipe repair, they don't. And that's the piece that I'm trying now to encourage, because what we're finding is that when I give somebody a map to go do a use permit inspection, there have been repairs that we have no evidence what happened. And we spend, you know, sometimes a couple of hours scratching our heads trying to make a determination of what actually happened. And, you know, was it us? Was it them? Those sorts of pieces. So if I can at least capture that information, that's all I'm looking for.
Okay. I don't see how the capture occurs, but fine.
So what you're saying is it may be advantageous for the homeowner to let you know that they've done some repairs, especially if down the road they're thinking about selling or listing.
Absolutely. Or in the case of replacing a pump in a system, you know, ensuring that the pump size is correct to what the engineer spec'd, because most homeowners don't have a copy of that, the original design. And so that's something where we can at least be able to advise people, here's what the engineer spec'd, is that what you guys are putting in? So, you know, it's a little bit of back and forth, and it's important for us to know, especially with pump. You know, that's an important piece that we really should know, that those pieces are being replaced. So
for example, I had a neighbor who had a pump fail, mm-hmm. and I was getting complaints because of the smell, mm-hmm. and so I called you to go see what the deal was, and you decided, yeah, it was just needed a new pump and they were going to fix it. So now that's in your system that they replaced that pump.
Right. Yeah. Right, and the type of pump that they replaced and who did the work. Or that's what I'm proposing we would do. Yeah.
So, but this, I think, what I visualize is that those are in septic systems that are permitted, right? We have a lot of systems that aren't permitted. Right? You don't have any records of septic systems for a third, half?
Oh, no, I don't think we have. I think we're probably 90-95% of the, it's probably got recorded of some type. You know, obviously newer systems we have better records for than older systems.
Because a newer system has a pump, right?
So well, our permit process is a little more robust than it was in the 70s or early 80s, yeah.
So it's complicated how to collect that information, and when somebody says, well, plus you're gonna have to pay $50 for telling us, it works against telling you, quite frankly. I mean, if your real goal is information mm-hmm. capture, mm-hmm. then you shouldn't be charging a fee, even $50, but.
But I got to pay for the software.
I know your costs. I see. But from the permittee's level, first of all, he wants to repair a system. He doesn't want to go through a bureaucracy, and he doesn't want to pay a fee. But he wouldn't mind telling you that he fixed his system. But if he knows he's going to have to go through a bureaucracy and pay a fee, it's an anti-incentive for gathering information. That's all I'm saying. So you tell me how that works. I, if I were going to be charged a fee for telling you something, I wouldn't do it.
Right, I think I agree. And maybe that's one aspect that we need to subsidize to gather that information.
Because it's really about information. Once you have that robust septic system, a new septic system, you can start to lay out what the requirements are. Now, I agree with that. But sort of backdating it, I can't see that that's a good system. Because you really want to gather information, and you really want to have people put in the best system they can. And if they're going to get charged money for telling you they fixed their system, they're just not going to do it. They're not going to tell you. They're just going to go ahead and fix it.
I think it's a perfect example of where one fee can subsidize another fee, where if you put the money, $50 up front in the first fee, and you estimate that each person is going to do one repair to their septic system over a period of time, and then you make the second thing free, well, you bank the $50 from the first fee, but you need the big picture to make sure that the department is balanced. And you know, you're not going to get that information of someone saying, well, I fixed my thing, here's $50.
Well, and I guess the piece that I should explain is, if we require a permit and they don't pull a permit, that's a violation that then, you know, you can penalize somebody for that. When I worked in Teller County, we adopted this. This is something that I had an issue in Teller County. We had a pipe repair permit. And that actually was not a piece that I understood. Most contractors I knew wanted that because they wanted that work on record and who did it, so that there weren't any questions later on. It actually protected them in the end, was their take. So I didn't, at least in my mind, I didn't have a compliance issue along those lines. Again, I charged a very minimal fee that just really didn't even cover our amount of time. It was just, let's get the information on record. Let's, you know, I'll meet you guys halfway. We'll cover 50% of the costs ourselves.
Yeah,
so
it just, I understand. It just, I just don't, I think, I agree with the goal of knowing what septic systems have been repaired. Mm-hmm. They've been prepared correctly. I don't agree in charging a fee for that information. That's all. And I think something along with what Rob's saying is the way to go.
Yeah. I think we're statutorily capped.
That was going to be
the
next point.
One of the reasons we don't have that flexibility is we're statutorily capped, which is one of the things we brought up with CCI on several occasions. And so we don't have the flexibility, Rob, to do what you're saying. So in this case, we do have to break it down so that if the mechanism for that information is in fact a permit, there's a separate permit fee that goes with that. And that is at your discretion whether we have that permit or not. At least in other locations, the contractors and such who are doing the work have seen that as a benefit, because then there's a place for the records.
So you mentioned you have to cover the cost of the software. Mm-hmm. The software also includes all the new permits and all the renewable permits. I mean, it's the same software program.
Right, right.
It's just not, so you've got one software program that you're going to utilize and purchase regardless, and then it's just a question of inputting,
right,
which is fairly nominal.
Right.
So, you know, I would go back to Sydney and say, Sydney, you need to raise this fee by a nickel or something, and that's used as a subsidy to cover this.
So you're saying no permits then, or?
Well, I'm not saying no permits. I'm saying yes to gathering information, and I'm saying no to making people pay to give you that information.
So the mechanism right now we have to get that information or to compel that information is a permit, right? Because otherwise it's just a voluntary program.
But let's clarify this. Yeah. We're talking about a pipe repair or even a pump repair, which is not particularly difficult, which is just reach down, pull it out, pop in a new one. And then within hours, two hours, you're set to go.
Right.
So it isn't particularly complicated, and it isn't particularly drastic, unless you vastly undersize or oversize and you screwed up the system. But that's not likely to happen, because people look at the pump and say, oh, this is a horse and a half. I'll put a horse and a half down. So that's the permitting. So that's kind of minor. It's not like we're permitting a septic system.
Right.
We're just permitting you to repair your septic system. But really our goal is not to permit, but our goal is to have the proper repairs done and information relayed to environmental health. That's the goal. And I'm just arguing that charging for that is not the way to get people to comply. That's all I'm saying.
And that's fine. I just, the flip side of that is, so would you issue a permit then at no charge for those kinds of repairs so that we could issue, so we could collect the information?
Yeah.
And there would be a consequence to not doing that.
Yeah.
Because there's no compulsion anywhere.
Yeah, I think, and the best consequences that we've had with septic systems is that transfer of title of the land or property to another person and have a record. And if you don't have that record complete or whatever, you're stuck with your septic system and non-sale of your property. So that's the best incentive.
And if we have a permit.
If you have a permit. Yeah. I mean, so that's a much better system for getting people to comply than saying, give me $50 for telling me you repaired your pipe.
So yes to the permit at zero cost.
Right.
Got it. So we'll have to make that change tomorrow
resolution. And, you know, that's, I don't know if
well,
these
I mean,
guys
I'm
agree.
Seeing at least
no,
one
I,
more
I
head
agree
nod.
With that. You know, this has been a good discussion. And I mean, if I had to pull my pump and throw a new pump in New Year's Day, I would just do it, and that'd be that. And, I'll tell you I did it, but wait a second. Now I have to tell you and pay you $50? I don't think so.
Well, we're still saying, though, that you're required to get a permit for that.
Well, I would actually phrase it differently.
Okay.
I would say that you have to make a record of your repairs to your septic system. You have to have a record. Permitting is different. My septic system is broken. It's a holiday or a long, it's the Thanksgiving season. I'm going to have trouble finding anybody to fix the goddamn thing in the first place.
Right.
Much less contact community development for a permit for it. But given that I do find somebody and we make a record of it, I wouldn't be averse to handing it into community development following Thanksgiving. I wouldn't have a problem with that. But a permit system, that's, you know, there's a whole thing going on.
Mm-hmm.
A permit for something that broke through no fault of my own, but a record of it, I can do that. I can show you my sales receipt, my horsepower, whatever the specs are, I'll hand that in, or keep it in the file.
And I'm just thinking through the mechanism then that captures it at that property transaction.
And I can't solve these problems.
Right, right.
I'm just telling you the dilemma of getting information and making people paying to supply you with that information.
I totally get that. I'm hearing that. But you also still want that kind of hook in there that at the point of property transaction, if that record hasn't been made, then that's a consequence as an incentive that
upon inspection, they say, wait a minute, none of this matches our original plans. What did you do? You better come up, you better have something that shows that you documented that with the community development.
Do you mind if I keep that dialogue? So, Kurt, is it possible to do for lack of a better term, I'm going to call it a permit, but like a post hoc permit that just certifies that, yep, this is the pump that is put in or the pipe in the repair and it's adequate. And so it's like a after the fact permit in a way. I'm not bright enough to think of a different word right now,
well,
but what you're going after is, hey, don't stop people from fixing their septic systems. Don't make it hard to do. Particularly at times when they're most likely to break, which is always holidays when there's nobody fixing, you're using them a lot, right? But yes, we do want something that's authoritative where we've captured the information and there's actually a consequence at the time of property transfer if you haven't complied with it, which is like a post hoc permit, if you will. It's an after the fact permit where you've, whoever's installed it provides the information a week later.
Right.
And if it is properly sized and such, you give it to them, and if not, you don't, and they still have that hook on.
And probably 99% of the people are going to use a contractor, and so you just let the contractors know this is the procedure.
And yeah, right. Well, and that we'll have a contractors meeting here in probably February, March, and that's when I anticipated at least rolling that concept out to those guys and starting to talk with them about it, although I have started with a few of them already.
And we don't charge for it.
And we don't charge for it.
Okay.
I'm glad this was the easy part of the discussion.
Well, compared to the last one, I think it is.
So should I not call it a perm? Should I even put it in the fee schedule?
I think, like Cindy, or what you mentioned, a certification.
I would put it in the fee schedule. I would actually put in the fee schedule at $0. You know, to say that, yes, this is actually, come up with a name, certification, certification or permit of some kind. And, we want you to, there's a broader public interest in this. There's zero fee to it. And then if the board changes their mind in the future, you've at least got it listed. You know that that's something that you've chosen to subsidize. And we can report back on it, is it working?
Well, we've chosen to gather information on our septic systems. Mm-hmm. That's our choice. I wouldn't call it a subsidy. We've chosen to have the best possible records of our septic systems. Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. So we'll change that tomorrow. And basically, the reason I'm also saying keep it in is it will be easy. You just simply, in the resolution with the motion, change that, what's it called right now?
Minor repair permit.
To certification and a zero fee. And we can do that. Whoever makes the motion tomorrow can do that.
Okay.
And then everything else, though, it sounds like you guys were okay with if there are multiple septics on a property and that clarification.
Okay.
Do you have any more?
That's no, yeah.
All right.
I actually have something. Yeah. This is for the building permit. I brought this up before. It's silk fencing. You have black silk fencing, and typically it goes up beautifully. It's nice and well done. But 2 months into the project, 3 months into the project, 2.4 years into the project, it has fallen down. It's neglected. It's terrible. There's got to be a better way to do this, because what happens is when it starts to fall down, the calculation is I was required to do this, and they don't really care about me, and so there has to be a better way of doing it, and I don't know what it is, but it undermines the necessity that you require people to do things, right? And anywhere you go, I can guarantee you that half of that silt fence has fallen down, unless it's a month-old project.
It's more of a long-term construction management plan.
Well, yeah, and it's not that I don't agree with the capturing of the silt and all that stuff, but the current method of doing it is doesn't work. It undermines your requirements.
Mm-hmm. That's all.
Thank you. Some tough topics. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thank you. It's good discussion.
So, the true concern is
property transition, use permit, divulge, and repairs made.
We're going to move right into future agendas for memos of interest, which are
none. There are none, so we can, I think you had the right call there, Rob.
Future agendas.
Brian, Kurt. Brian, Kurt.
We're going to continue.
May seem over to you.
Well, and this will be fairly short too. Obviously, with the discussion we just had, for tomorrow we'll be pulling the ordinance for the change in community development fees. That will also change then on our December 15th agenda. We put those fees on with adoption of the budget. We'll keep the environmental health one as will be amended tomorrow. The probably item that's not captured on here is retreat dates, and I have gotten feedback from everyone now, and I hope these dates still work, but it's looking like February 23rd and 24th, which I believe is a Monday and Tuesday. We're looking like dates, the earliest dates that would work for everybody. Yeah, those are last Monday and Tuesday in February. Okay.
It's good for me.
So, what's that?
It's good for me.
Okay. And Michael, I think that fit with the directions you gave us. Does that work for you still?
Do I gave February. Direction?
Well, yeah, not Friday or the weekend.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, except Monday. No, I'm just.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we'll get that. We'll get that scheduled. And other than that, I.
So, based on this discussion we just had, if ComDev is able to get this back to us next week, next Tuesday, right now the morning is wide open.
Yeah. So we'll look at that. I'll visit with them, and we can get that fit in. We moved everything into the afternoon for December 9th. We could even, if the board wanted, do a working lunch if you just wanted to start at noon and go through versus coming in at 11 for an hour or maybe hour and a half and taking lunch. Do you have a preference there?
Well, I'm sorry, I lost.
So we're on Tuesday, December 9th. We're going to bring back the community development fees discussion. Right now the morning's completely open. We don't start until 1. It's just asking the board's preference. Would you rather have a working lunch and start at noon and go straight through, or come in for an hour and take a lunch?
I just didn't have a working lunch.
So we start at 12.
Yeah, just go straight through. Does that work for you? Good for you, Rob.
Good for me.
We will do that.
And we have solid waste overview on that day as well for an hour.
Yeah, and what we may do, depending on what our memos of interest and such look like, is I think we may want a little bit more time for that first discussion. And so we may consolidate, crunch the memos of interest and future agenda discussions, because those are getting pretty short towards the end of the year here. Make a little bit more time.
We had talked about moving board reports on to another day where more people are here, unless anybody has anything pressing to say. So we'll find a time sometime in the future to plug board reports and open discussion.
Yeah, I've got two items that came to us today. First one I'll hand around. You all may have already gotten this email from Carrie Donovan, who was recently elected state senator in Senate District 5. She's asking for pretty quick turnaround. We, of course, will have to provide her feedback on that right away. She is looking for pretty quick turnaround on the items that we consider most important. I think she's reached out to elected officials within her district. She's got a checklist there. She hasn't asked for prioritization or anything of that nature. Looks like just kind of checking off the items that we think are most important and then providing any comments. She is looking to have this back by December 4th, I believe. So, wasn't sure if the board would want to do this individually or if you want to take a few minutes to talk about it and make sure we're checking the same things. We need a couple minutes to look at it there and talk.
I guess for me, I have to understand from her position what the state could actually be able to do or have an influence on versus perhaps more of a federal level. Let's, for example, the pill.
Pill.
You know, are they really, is she really going to be able to do anything? Sure, certainly it's a concern of ours, but I'm not sure what sort of influence the state senate would or the house would have.
So I think you're right, George, and I think on some of these issues it's going to be more about what could she do in her role as a state senator in terms of advocacy. So mm-hmm. You know, PILT is an advocacy issue right now for particularly local governments that are impacted by it. The same may be true on conservation issues. So, for example, we may want to talk to her about Thompson Divide and our mm-hmm. position there. That could have both state but more federal implications. Other areas where the state will be making direct decisions, you know, broadband, oil and gas, healthcare costs, airport access. These are all areas that the state, through various agencies and such, would have direct impact on, and she may have opportunities to make policy decisions. And my sense of what she's doing right now is trying to get some idea where her new constituency has energy. What are the areas that she may need to come up to speed on or learn more about? And develop positions on which does she already have a set role. I don't have any more information than you do here as
yeah,
far as...
But I think it's important that we respond because we want to
right.
establish a strong rapport with Carrie right off the bat and have her on our side when we need her to help on. So I think we don't want to just ignore this. We want to provide her with some input, and even though it may not be complete, at least she's heard from us and we started a line of communication.
Yeah, and I can count 10 things that on this list that we all have, that we have initiatives on as a county, and I don't know if that's overwhelming or not to check basically half of her boxes.
No, I think that's what we should do is say these are the issues this big county is working on. These are the issues we prioritize, and I don't care that it doesn't have any relationship. Might have some relationship, but not complete relationship with our list. That's fine. Just reaching out to know what we're concerned about.
And maybe even use some examples. So, for example, if we look at conservation, use Thompson Divide as an example, mm-hmm. or the PIL as an example in terms of what it means for our budget.
Or the Valley Health Alliance. You know, yeah. Those are things that we are working on, and
So is it worth, I doubt you look at all of it, but we've got one or two pagers on all these things just while we're doing.
Send them off.
Check them and attach them and ship them off?
Yeah.
Okay. So can I just go, I'm assuming water rights is a check. Agriculture? And then,
I mean, it's just not a major concern. We don't have it as a major concern. I mean, in terms of economy for the county. Now, we just talked about agricultural leases for open space.
Right.
But that's
different. Heritage agriculture. But
yeah.
Other than that,
yeah, it's not.
Well, let me go through the ones I think we had checked. So water rights, recreation, tourism, conservation, affordable housing.
Broadband.
Pelt, domestic violence, healthcare costs, renewable energy, airport access, senior care.
Yeah, but I mean, domestic violence. What is that? I mean, that's like we're for it or against it. I mean,
but we're definitely against it.
but do we have a program based?
Well, we do actually, you know, we've launched the public outreach campaign between Human Services and the Sheriff's Department, and, you know, been working with programs through the nonprofits.
Well, so that's why I think sending out what we're doing.
Yeah. So that's what I think, to give some context, like you're saying, we can attach either, you know, the charters that we've done as part of our strategic planning, or the work that we've started doing in these areas, and invite her up for a more full-blown discussion at some point. Mm-hmm. Okay, we can do that. The other item that came our way, and this is one we don't necessarily need to act on today, give me just a sec here to get these organized. There's one. And this came, I think, through the Sonoran Institute, Jim Spehart, the Sonoran Institute.
Two pages, George. With that. Yeah. So the first things that I sent you were together.
Oh, sorry about
that's
that.
Right. Yeah. Just find two pages that don't match.
This is the same
for President Obama.
I'm making you work. So basically, this came through George, I believe, to you through Jim Spehart, and then Rachel also had it come to her at CCI. Both Senator Bennett and Senator Udall are encouraging President Obama to designate the Browns Canyon area on the Arkansas River as a national monument. They're looking for support from elected officials, not necessarily directly, who are directly affected, but at least in the area, to show support for that designation. I do have a call-in to my peer in Chaffee County. I haven't heard back from him yet, just to make sure we understand what position the Chaffee County commissioners have taken on it. I think the information we got today was that a majority were in support, but I don't know exactly what that means. So the request is for us to send a letter, like the one that starts, Dear President Obama, in support of designating the Browns Canyon area as a national monument. That basically gives it, that can be done through executive order, basically puts it under the National Park Service, and it's managed much like a national park, under the same kinds of restrictions. It looks like the BLM has recognized it as a wilderness study area, which would typically lead to designation as a national conservation area. That takes congressional action, and I guess this has been held up for some time now. So I guess the question for the board is, we can bring this back next Tuesday. One, I wanted you to be aware that discussion was hanging out there. We can spend a little bit of time getting information on what position, if any, Chaffee County's taken. And then does the board, if Chaffee County supports this and is asking for our support, are you interested in us drafting a letter similar to the one that's attached?
Sure. It would be nice to know if there was opposition, what it is.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's great to talk to all the people that are in favor of it, but
yeah.
To hear the other side is good information.
Well, and I thought Chaffee County could probably give us some information on that.
Yeah.
And then the last item for open discussion, this is one that probably is not as timely but still needs to be addressed, is we've been trying to set up a meeting with representatives from the U.S. Postal Service, and Charlotte and Susan have been working on that, and we're still trying to get them in to give us a briefing on all the potential changes that may be affecting post offices in Pitkin County. But we did, what teed this up was the proposed reduction in services in Woody Creek, and we just have not been able to get that scheduled at this point. And so the question is, do we now, do you want staff to draft a letter? I know Michael's expressed some interest in the past of staff drafting a letter of basically concern on behalf of the board about changes that are being initiated in hours of service and such at the post office. And we can get that on
the caucus Tuesday. Actually has in a resolution.
I saw that.
For support.
Oh, they've asked for a resolution of support.
They had a resolution.
Okay.
Asking the commissioners to oppose any reduction in hours at the post office in Woody Creek. That's how this thing started.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it would be good if we at some point could get a representative here, because Woody Creek is, maybe that's just the tip of the iceberg, because you've got, you know, Thomasville, there's a post office up there, and even DeSalt, I mean, who knows? Old Snowmass, I mean, we've got some very small rural post offices, and it'd be good to sort of see what their long-range thinking is, knowing that the U.S. Post Office service is basically bankrupt. Anyway,
well, we're still trying to get that set up. That timeline is continuing to get stretched, and as Michael said, we have the caucus who's asked the commissioners for support, and I think the most immediate way to provide that support would be for us to draft a letter of, you know, noting our concern and opposing changes, but that I wanted to get some direction.
And not just for Woody Creek, I would just say based on all of our
right
small rural post offices that
okay
that
and then
still
invite the discussion.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all I've got for open discussion. Oh, I'm sorry, one more thing. The IT network transition has been completed. It went smoothly. It was done department by department over about a six-week period, and so the county is now running on its own network through ProVelocity. All the departments have been converted at this point.
So if there's a problem, who do we call?
ProVelocity, and you should we've got mouse pads and all kinds of things with their number on it. You know, I just want to acknowledge that for such a major transition, you know, that was what we've been contracting for 30 years. That went really smoothly. There were little hiccups, but they were all addressed pretty much the same day a department was brought over onto the network. So encourage you to talk to folks about it as you go around, but you all have been brought over too. It should be pretty seamless.
Well, the early transition to the Google Drive and all that stuff probably really helped in that. So it was very good foresight in terms of the planning of how that went.
So that's it for open discussion for me.
Commissioners?
We have a joint meeting with City Council at 4 o'clock?
At 4 o'clock, we'll be hearing from the pod and on I guess, nonprofit trends and issues and...
Is that running from 4 to 6, or who's running that meeting? Are we running?
Steve's turn to chair that one, I believe.
But we're scheduled to be out by 6?
Yeah.
We're scheduled to be out by 6, and there are only two items. One's a major update on Health and Human Services.
Right, yeah.
But future, and the other...
Could be lengthy discussions.
Potentially. I think the IGA is pretty straightforward at this point.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, good.
All right. All right, I'll adjourn the meeting. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, guys.